and welcome back to Still Eligible. I'm Jack. Pat is across from me. We are 6 feet at least away from each other. COVID, national championship, football, Dawgs win again, the whole nine yards, Pat. This is the second time we've done the virtual podcast. There's a guy blowing leaves outside my window. I'm happy to be here. What's up?
Not a whole lot. I will say have COVID. I'm waiting on a test where potentially during this episode I could get a test that says that I no longer have it. But I got it. We're going to talk about that in the sense of we literally went the entire fall with traveling and never got it, and then I get it the week after we come back, which is absolutely insane.
That's what's mind-blowing. Yeah. We've been all over the country for over a year now, and I don't know, as far as we're concerned, we never had COVID, but here you are. I don't know, saved us a trip to the office today. No one can't pay those toll tags every time.
I know.
I did the math. It's like $3 to go to the office every time. $3 there and $3 back, I think. What are we doing?
Yeah, so strategically, this worked out. But yeah, I also, not to make too light of COVID, but I mean, we're both vaccinated, which I think just makes it easier. And then I actually got my booster, I think like a day before I tested positive. So timing there was impeccable. I don't know if that cancels out the booster or what that does, but
you might have to reboost it.
Yeah. So here we are, but I'm feeling good. Luckily we had a mild case. So yeah, just very ironic to get it after all of my friends all fall were like, how do you not have COVID? And, now I can say I've had it. So,
well, what do you think the top few places we should have gotten COVID this year were?
I would say, I think the Grove comes to mind for the amount of people
this secret grilled cheese. I feel like it was pitch black in there, and I feel like there's just COVID on the tabletops. That comes to mind. I was going to say Arkansas. I just think the state of Arkansas probably all has COVID.
I had that. That came to mind. I will say, I think the Bama game, I mean, other than the games you've gone to recently, like every other game, I would always tell people, like, we're sitting outside, like, during the games, but, like, and we're not around people because we have credentials. But, like, Alabama, we were sitting in the stands, surrounded by people. That probably wasn't great either. I think our hotel room in Gainesville, even though we had our own rooms, that place was so sketchy. I think we probably should have just gotten it.
What I had for Alabama was just being around Nacho Alabama. That guy looks like he just can't get rid of COVID. I saw him this weekend. It was good to reunite with him. Truly a special man. And then I said the Waka concert in the basement. I think that there was more floating around in the air than COVID that night, but that was another one that could have been. And the field storm at Baylor, that was early on in our tenure, but we were wearing masks, but it was one of those things where it's like, dude, you're here. Why are you even wearing a mask? So there you go. Pups in the house. So
we got some dogs. Speaking of the dogs winning again, I got my girlfriend's dogs are on high alert right now for some reason. So if they bark, that's why. But dogs won again. We just said, very ironic to get COVID after the year that we just had. But part of the Omicron gang now. So hopefully my body will be stronger coming out of this. I'm not a doctor, but who knows?
Well, we were saying last week that we were going to be live tweeting the game and doing all this stuff and to follow along on social media. And, Pat was on lockdown. I decided to – I was at – so first of all, I guess this is a longer story than people might realize. I was in Tulsa this weekend. My girlfriend's friend was having this gender reveal party, which if you've never been to a gender reveal party, it's truly something magnificent to be a part of. I don't know. I need to get a bookie on gender reveal parties. I'm one for one on betting on gender reveals. And truly, it is one of the most fun things I've ever been a part of. Not only the gender reveal, but being a part of like the gambling side of it, which like there needs to be an underground world for this, because there's nothing as like, so they shot like these little cannon things that shoots confetti out. There's so many different ways that people get creative with it, but it's almost more like, I feel like it was more nerve wracking for me than for them, because I had money on the line. They just want a healthy baby. So yeah, I was there. I won $10, shout them out. They're getting a baby boy sometime around July 1st. But after the gender reveal happened, I was inside having some snacks and whatever. I get a phone call from my buddy, and I probably shouldn't have answered it. But for some reason I did. I just said, I'll be right back. Stepped outside, got a phone call saying, hey, if you can make it to Indy or Nashville in the morning, I got a ticket and a free plane ride for you. To go to the game, and that's pretty much all I needed to hear. I came back inside and had Southwest pulled up. My girlfriend was like, what are you doing? Where do you think you're going? I was like, the national championship. So, yeah, drove back from Tulsa that night to Dallas. I think I got in there around, like, 9 or 10, and then was on a plane at, like, 6 to get to Nashville. Drove from Nashville to Indy with my buddy and his friend, and I got a couple guys backed out last minute, and sure enough, I'm a big enough sucker to hop on that train. There were two of the four of us were Georgia fans. My buddy, he's I guess going viral as we speak. he's actually an Auburn fan, so he hates Alabama and he hates Georgia. And I went with the Rob Lowe effect of the just the generic NCAA hat. But oh man, do we have a time? It was something to be in Indianapolis this weekend.
Yeah, that video, we right before the call started, we checked the numbers, and it is, it could get like a million views today, but possibly. I mean, it's like 4 o'clock and it's got like 500,000 views. So that's insane.
Not a bad day.
You texted me on, I'm going to pull it up. I think you texted me on Sunday.
And I texted you right after I got that phone call.
Yeah. And it was just like, I think I may be going. And I was just like, okay, it's pretty late in the process, but
the game's tomorrow.
Yeah. No, that's insane. And the gender reveal part is amazing. So congrats on going. Congrats congrats on winning the bet. And then, I guess what else happened that was eventful? Because I mean, the game early on was not super eventful. I think you had.
Well, I'll tell you, our pregame was rather eventful. We went to the hotel, checked in, dropped the bags, and got out of there. Like, we got to get downtown towards the game. Went to some place called Tiki Bob's because there was no line there. Like, we wanted to go to a couple other places that were recommended, and then there was no line at Tiki Bob's, and we were just trying to get drinks. So it didn't make a difference. And then we started walking around trying to find another place to go. And I found this tent that was just like a Georgia tent. And it was like a legit tent, like not just like a tailgate tent, but like it was like an alumni event where there was like free food, free drinks. They were giving out like pork tenderloins and beer and all this stuff. And we were walking by. I was like, guys, just follow my lead. Because this is like literally what we talk about all season, is like acts like you know what we're doing and just own the place. So I was like, follow my lead. We just walk right into this Georgia tent, and it's like this small, like not small, it's like this decent sized Georgia tent, food, drinks galore, whatever. And it's like kind of winding down, and we like are like, all right, let's bounce, let's go somewhere else. Like, we'll take the free food, take the free drinks. And we turn the corner into like this massive Georgia pregame party that's just like even bigger. There's a stage. I started talking to this lady, convinced her I was a Georgia alumni. I found this like credential on this table that just like gave you all access to the Georgia event. And yes, that was pretty much our pregame. And by the time we got in there for kickoff, I think we all could have, you know, taken the field and suited up because nothing was stopping us when we got in there. And then, like you said, like the game first half, not the most eventful thing. 6-9 at halftime. I mean, I think the energy in there was ridiculous. We talked about that at the SEC championship and how loud people were and how rowdy people were and how like this rivalry is real and how they played the Natty a few years ago and all that stuff. But like being in there and being such a close game and a low scoring game at that, and Georgia's defense, absolute dogs. We know that, but I mean, it was awesome to be a part of the was like my first Natty outside of the College World Series in any sport. And I mean, obviously, football is not a bad one to attend. And, yeah, I mean, the 6-9 at halftime, that was – I think that's what made it – like, everyone was on edge. Everyone was, like, knew that we still had a game on our hands. And, like, it was like the first person to score is going to take over this game, which kind of isn't necessarily true. But it was – yeah, I mean, it was awesome.
Yeah, I was – I mean, the weird thing about, I guess, the COVID thing is that – it was kind of like I knew the game was on Monday, and like I made it pretty clear to like both you and our boss. I was like, yeah, you know, I don't feel like terror. Like it sucks to have. It's not fun to have. It definitely affects you. No. But like, I was also like on Monday. Like there's certain jobs where you can't do your job with COVID, and for us, obviously the travel part that applies. But like, I texted you. I was like, yeah, I mean, I'm still, it's not like I'm sitting there and I can't open my laptop. Like I can still tweet the game or help out with that. And the problem was the first half, they're just
there's
like,
nothing to tweet.
There's nothing on the field. So it's like a couple of things happened before the game, like that I thought were funny. Like everybody was Bryce Young. They'd flash some graphic and they were comparing him and Stetson Bennett. And it was like, talking about Bryce Young's haters, and I like go on Twitter and I was like, oh, this has to be like popping off, like everybody's got to be talking about it. There were like five people talking about it, like no one had screenshotted the graphic or whatever. I was just like, what am I supposed to tweet during this game? And like I think that's something that a lot of people who have never worked in sports or in media, it's like it's kind of a terrifying moment. And like my thought process too is like, oh well, I'm going to wait for something notable or something a little more tweet-worthy to happen. But at the same time, I knew in the back of my mind, I was like, you're not going to give me, you know, like I have COVID. So that's a good excuse if I don't do a good job tweeting this game, but also not. And then some pictures started kind of like that sleepy Ugga picture people were using, and things started appearing and started being used, so it became a little easier. But like, I mean, I guess I'm just curious, because this video is popping off, like when, like, did you just come up with that on the fly, or was that like you were thinking of doing it from the get-go?
No, that was not the intent. I don't know. Like I said, we were well on our way, for lack of a better term, and we were just having fun. And then, so I'm wearing the hoodie that he was wearing. So I went with a CFP vest and the NCAA hat. And I brought him, he's like, just bring me some stuff. Like, I'll see what we do, like, whatever. And then, like, we get to the hotel, we change real quick, and he threw on the PFG and this hoodie. And he's like, I'm just going to go for it. And I was like, I've been there. I did that for the Oklahoma-Texas game. And then, yeah, I don't know. Then sure enough, it happened. And I was like, wait, like, you got to make sure I get this on tape. And then, yeah, we just kept rolling with it. But we were in the Bama section. So the tickets were cheaper for Alabama seats, I guess, because they've been there 9,000 times and it's been 41 years or whatever since Georgia won.
Yeah.
And we were the only Georgia fans in that section. And like I said, like, I guess it was like three Georgia fans and me, but I was basically like, all right, I'll root for Georgia. And I guess my friend was going on both sides, but the two other guys we were with were like all in on Georgia. So we were getting some looks for sure. But Georgia fans were loud and proud. Did you see the article? The Georgia fans, you know how they do the dog call, like the calling of the dogs? They got the police calling on them at St. Elmo's, which is like the big, like, there's like a few steakhouses that are like well known in Indianapolis, and St. Elmo's is known for their cocktail shrimp, which we actually had at the Georgia pregame tailgate thing. But they were calling the Dawgs at St. Elmo's, and it's like screaming, carrying on. I don't know the full, I should know it. I don't know the full like chant, but the cops showed up, and not only anything happened, but the Georgia fans were loud and proud, and they took up most of the stadium. I'd say probably 60-40, not most, but you know, more than half. So it was sweet. It was sweet to be a part of.
I did hear about the air, like I think in the airport they were barking, and like it sounded like the entire trip there were probably fans doing. And based on what we've interacted with them, some of the most ridiculous fans we've talked to are Georgia fans. So I'm not surprised.
People were barking at people the whole game, and then like post game, like you just won your first natty in forever. Post game. I kid you not, we get outside and people, it's freezing cold out, which makes it even funnier because it's like the game's in Indianapolis, like where the Big Ten championship is, and these SEC people roll up and they're just like owning the city and having fun. But these Georgia fans are barking at anyone and everyone, whether you're a Georgia fan or an Alabama fan. I mean, people were getting in each other's faces. And I mean, Kirby Smart, where was his quote? He said, like, there's going to get some stuff destroyed.
Yeah, property. Indianapolis.
There's gonna get some property, and like when he said that, I swear it was almost louder in the stadium than like when the final whistle went off. Like Georgia fans were going nuts, and I don't know. Like I'm sure Alabama people would have been going nuts, but like I said, they've been there before, they've experienced this before. These Georgia fans were absolutely wild. So
yeah, when I heard him say that, I was like, that's. More property is obviously gonna get broken. All right, dogs bark again. I was like, more property is gonna get broken because of him saying that, obviously, than not. But it's just like, I mean, I think it was also, I never actually looked this up, but I believe like when they last won the title, maybe like the quarterback said something like that. I think
it was the radio announcer said it in like 1980. At the Florida Georgia game, Larry Munson said it. So yeah, whatever. It was bringing it back to life. But yeah, I mean the game was nuts. I think start to finish, the fourth quarter. I mean the first three quarters were huge defensively, and then the fourth quarter was just like what you wanted was a good fourth quarter. And then my favorite like thing I saw on social media was like when Ringo got the interception and Kirby's jumping in midair. Georgia posted like the video of like. Both of them like in midair at the same time, bouncing up and down. I mean, like there's multiple times that stadium went crazy. Obviously, that one sealing the national championship was the loudest. People barking, people going crazy, but that was cool. And then when I got back, I saw like the post game handshake, and Saban said like you guys kicked our ass in the fourth quarter, and you know. Whatever. And I think we've seen a lot more of Saban this year being on the softer side of things, where it's like, I mean, obviously the rat poison thing, and like people said like this isn't his best team, and they're already the number one like most like favorite for to win the natty next year. I think Saban knows like this wasn't his best team, and like he was just happy to make it there. I don't know if he would say that, and probably not in front of his guys, but it was interesting to see that. And like he's laughing and smiling, and I mean it's Nick Saban. Like him losing a national championship that doesn't happen often, and him being, I don't know, he seemed laid back for what it was worth. I mean, I don't know if laid back's the right word, but it was interesting seeing him like that as well.
Yeah, the press conference moment, obviously, with our guy Will Anderson Jr. and Bryce Young. I don't know if he would have done that a few years ago. And well, yeah, kind of like you said, I mean, to witness that rat poison comment in person, that to me was kind of like, I don't know. I think he's just kind of realizing he may not have that much time. I mean, he can coach for as long as he wants. He can coach till he dies, really, if he wants to there. But I think he's just kind of realizing in his older age that he's not going to be able to do this forever, and to try to enjoy it a little bit more. But yeah, the fact that they're ranked number one going into next year, and some of the stats about the amount of 4 and 5 stars that they have and Georgia has compared to everybody else is just ridiculous. So as a Michigan fan, I think Saban leaving is probably good for like every other top 10 program, and I'm glad that I can say that Michigan is a top 10 program again, but at the same time, like, as I always say, as a college football fan, it's like he's a legend, and I mean, I think the game is better with him, and he's kind of, I don't know, some of these recent rule changes too. I feel like at one point everybody was kind of against him because he was, you know, kind of benefiting the most from some of these rules, and now some of the transfer rules and NIL stuff has made it so that, like, there's more, obviously, teams that can beat in Alabama, and I think he's kind of realizing that, I don't know, you can't be a robot all the time. So I'm enjoying it, but yeah.
It'll be interesting to see how much longer he coaches. I know people are asking about, like, will this be his last? And I'm like, with next year being a number one, the most favored team going into the year, like, you'd imagine he'd keep it rolling and whatever. Actually, like, I don't know what you just said that made me think of it, but last week I was doing some weird, like, research. Sometimes I just get in the depths of, like, Wikipedia and Google.
Oh, yeah.
And, like, Joe Pa coached, like, Joe Pa died, like, 81, I want, like, it might be like 86, something around, like, less than 100 days after he coached his last football game. I was like, imagine being Joe Pa's wife and being like, all right, like, you're done coaching. Or I don't even know, he might have been coaching the next year, and, you know, he just kicks the can like 80 days later. Like, there's no retirement there. That man lived football, for what it's worth. One of my favorite things, and we can get into, there's a ton of stuff to get into. There's a few of my favorite post game things, but the number 35 on Georgia, his name is John Statton. He's a grad student. I think he's got 3 tackles on the year, but there's a video of him just pounding beers on the field, like, after the game, like, as soon as it ended. And I love that, especially from a college kid. Like, I mean, you see that, like, in the NBA locker rooms or the champagne or whatever, and, like, half the team can't even drink. My man's a grad student, just 3 tackles on the year and pounding beers. I thought that was funny. And then, obviously, the N'Kobe Dean thing, like, popped off on social media. And I didn't even see that until I was hurting the next day. I didn't even see that until, like, way, way after. But the wearing the Alabama hat, he had the Alabama – N'Kobe Dean for Georgia was wearing the Alabama National Championship hat, and that was just entertaining to say.
How did that even get onto the field is –
I want to know if someone, like, I don't know, because if I was in charge of the hats, like, my ass, like, I'd probably take an Alabama hat and just throw it in the Georgia pile too, just to try to spark some stuff. But I don't know, like, how does that, this is like the biggest, like, so much stuff goes into this game we talked about last week, and, like, how does something like that happen? I don't know. But, and it's funny that was a good player. Like, if it wasn't a good player, it would be significantly less funny, but the fact that,
yeah,
it was N'Kobe Dean makes it even better. So there you go. What else you want to, I mean, I think we've got a lot to say about Stetson Bennett, but I know that's probably breaking into something ahead of us. So do you want to jump into that?
Yeah. I mean, I think just, yeah, I guess the only other thing is that we saw the picture of, our other guy, Jordan Davis, holding the trophy. And I don't know if I've ever seen a person happier in a photograph. So obviously we got to know him and he's the man and super excited. I was looking at some mock drafts just before this, and he's actually rising up. He could be like a top 10 pick. So super, super happy for him.
My favorite was the video of him, like, doing the, looking in the trophy as, like, a mirror, and there's, like, kind of wiping off his face and stuff. Georgia Football posted it. And whatever, you gotta love these guys having fun with the trophy. It was his birthday yesterday. Shout him
out. It was. Happy birthday.
Like, whatever. He looks like he's 40, but he's turning 20. What, 22?
Yeah, he said something like 27 in parentheses or something, because he's just, I mean, he doesn't look that old, but it's just these guys are like, I don't know. And even with Will Anderson, it's like, he seems so much smaller, but I think if it was just me, you, and Will hanging out in, like, normal clothes too, it's like, he's like a massive human being. But I think everything was just skewed because Jordan Davis. Didn't he tell you that he, like, varies? He tweeted something.
He fluctuates. You say, like, fluctuates from, like, 320 to 380 or, like, 330 to 3. I'm like, dude, nobody fluctuates 50 pounds. Like, I haven't put on weight since high school. But that's just me. I don't know. That dude's massive. Will Anderson just walks like he's going to kill somebody. He's ridiculous. And like you said, it'll be crazy to see him and Bryce Young run it back next year. And Saban's post-game press conference, keeping them around and saying how much, you know, these guys put on the line this year. And I mean, that's cool. Like I said, it's like you're seeing more of Saban as like an actual human being versus like robot Saban or whatever Saban has been in the past. And it's cool. So, yeah, there you go.
I'm also just going to note that Mississippi State fans do not enjoy it when you say Dogs win again.
In reference to anything,
even if you do use a picture that literally we've been using the entire year of one William Braswell, that was like that tweet got the most engagement of anything that we posted, just simply because people do not like you using that. That's ruffled some feathers. And also, if you're looking to make a bet here, I have yet to cough on this podcast, and I'm really trying not to. But I'm also
I only do gender reveals.
I feel like every time I laugh harder, there's a greater chance of me coughing. So I'm really trying to make it through this episode without coughing from an optics standpoint, but if that's why I'm not laughing as much as I usually would be, it's not because of your jokes. It's because I'm really trying to trick myself into either believing or actually not having COVID anymore. So again, I keep checking whatever for this test result, but I don't know. I appreciate it. Preciate yas. You all know this segment. We use Jack's catchphrase. We let people know that we appreciate them. Like Jack was alluding to, Stetson Bennett, I'm sure if you are a college football fan, you saw the video. He was on Good Morning America. I believe it was an 8 a.m. interview. And his Instagram story the night before, he was throwing back some drinks. The game did not end early, by the way.
No, the game didn't end early, but doesn't he have a flip phone? How does he post on Instagram stories? He got an iPod Touch or something? That's what I want to know. Like,
he's got iPad? Yeah.
He's got to be connected to the Wi-Fi at the team hotel and on his iPad or something. I want to know where that came. If he's on a flip phone, there's no way.
I didn't even think about that. He's probably got someone. Well, there goes the cough. Bet if you were betting, he's probably got someone connected to his account. But yeah, I don't know. That's a way to kind of stay in touch with current tech. But then I guess he doesn't get the distractions and someone else is managing his Instagram story then, I guess. I don't really know.
We got to get to the bottom of this.
I mean, I saw he was like drinking he had like some high noons. He had like a case and it was like 8 a.m. interview tomorrow. Pray for me. And I don't know if everybody, if you haven't watched the interview, look it up. I mean, my guy, he kept saying he was like, he got a few hours of sleep. And I think Michael Strahan was kind of laughing at his expense because he was kind of taking a while to like answer the questions, and I don't want to speculate too much, but it's like you figure he was going out pretty late. I saw the iPad or iPod Touch Instagram story. Like, I'm assuming he drank some of those drinks. Like, I don't know how he was feeling, but it was just kind of like, I remember in college, like, we had some team lifts that were pretty early, like 6 a.m., and people were definitely still kind of feeling it the next day, but it was never a situation where you had to go on Good Morning America. So no. good for him for waking up.
I can assure you I was probably worse off than Stetson on Monday night, and there was no chance I was prepared to do anything of the sorts. I mean, the Stetson Bennett just as a whole, I think I heard an interview of him saying like, what if you win? Like, what would be sweet for you? And he said to smoke cigars like Joe Burrow. I mean, his nickname is the mailman. I think the whole story of Stetson Bennett being like the modern day Rudy, like underdog story, the walk on, like he walked on, then he transferred to, what was it called? Jones College or something like that.
Yeah.
And transferred back to Georgia, lifelong Georgia fan. I mean, He had no offers. Like, I think that like the whole story of what JT Daniels is, and obviously like he'll be able to, I think they made a joke about that on Good Morning America, is like, you'll never have to pay for a drink again. Like, if I'm Stetson Bennett, like, I'm trying to figure out how to capitalize on this now, like open up Stetson's, and like, what if that's a restaurant or if it's a sporting goods store or whatever, like just run Athens, Georgia for the rest of my life.
Oh, yeah.
And I mean, people love him, and people will always love him. And the fact that he grew up a Georgia fan makes it even sweeter. So, I mean, I'm here for the Stetson Bennett bandwagon, whatever you want to call it, flip phone and all. So, yeah, I think it's just a cool story. So much love on that. Oh, I have made a note. Do you remember Jason White? I feel like he's a shittier Jason White. Jason White, like, won the Heisman. He won the Heisman for Oklahoma, and then like he had like knee problems and never got drafted, never did anything in the NFL. I think that Stetson Bennett is a shittier Jason White on the field, but he'll be remembered longer. Like, people, I don't think people will remember Jason White as long as Stetson Bennett. Hot take, weird take, but it's a take nonetheless.
Yeah, I mean, he said on the interview too, he's like, I'm going to play, because he has eligibility still. He said, I'm going to play football this next year. Like, we'll see where. I don't know if that was just him being really hungover and forgetting that he plays for Georgia, or just him kind of saying, you know, we got to see what he's talking about, you know, you got a player like JT Daniels, you got other talented quarterbacks. It's like, are you going to stay somewhere where you win the Natty 1 year and then you get passed up the next year? And it's kind of similar to the Michigan situation with Cade McNamara, and everybody wants JJ McCarthy to play. And from a talent standpoint, that's like a no brainer. But yeah, I agree. I mean, especially with this NIL stuff, I hope he comes back. And
if I'm him, I'm coming back, and like, I don't even care if I play. Like, just start cashing in. Just whatever. I'm cashing in. Like, people are surprised all year that he kept playing over JT Daniels and whatever. And obviously, like, happy for Stetson. But man, why would you transfer to insert school here when you can just be the king on campus and run the show there?
Yeah, if you have I don't see him playing the NFL. I mean, people were joking about like Belichick drafting him as a slot receiver, but he's not athletic. Like, it's not like he's like a fast
5'11" or whatever.
Yeah,
allegedly,
I think he's actually, people were saying he's actually closer to like 5'9". So that's, it's like dating app height. But Stetson Bennett, for powering through a way too early morning interview and keeping it somewhat together, appreciate ya.
The nickname Mailman's undefeated too. I'm a big fan of that. Yeah, appreciate you, Stetson Bennett, as well, even though that's not mine. But my first one goes out to the PGA Tour and Netflix collab. We tweeted something yesterday, but the Tour and Netflix teaming up like they did for F1 Drive to Survive, documentary behind the scenes access to some of the best names in golf. I mean, some of the names on there: Fleetwood, Fowler, DJ, Koepka, Poulter, Spieth, Thomas, Watson. I mean, there's a ton of them already on there. And I mean, this just excites me. Obviously, we love sports, we love golf, we love film, we love all this stuff, and to see it kind of come together is awesome. And I love the F1 series. I think a lot of people did. I think people love golf. I think more people already love golf than like already loved F1. So this will be a cool inside the look of, I mean, I love Hard Knocks. I love all that stuff, all the stuff behind the scenes. And that's kind of what we're trying to do here, is right, give people a different look at stuff, a different angle of stuff. And I think that the golf Netflix collab is something that's truly going to pop off. And I mean, for sure, I'm going to tune into along the way. So I guess my first one goes out to the PGA and Netflix. Appreciate you.
Yeah, I don't see Bryson on the list, which
I'm sure that is ever changing, right?
Yeah. It's like,
imagine if Tiger comes back. Oh, brother.
Oh my God. Yeah. I mean,
I wonder what these guys are getting paid too, because obviously there's something going on there. But like, could you imagine how much they'd have to like pay Tiger, and I don't know if Tiger would do it. I mean, yeah, based on Tiger's history, I don't know if he would do it, but it would be sweet. I mean, especially the later end of his career, all that goes with it. That'd be nuts.
I mean, it's for a sport like golf too. It's like, I mean, I would love to go to some tournaments and see this up close, but it's like they are. I was shocked when this news dropped because, like, they're notoriously just, like, heavily guarding the players and, like, it's obviously, yeah.
That and, like, that being, like, a mental – I mean, every sport's mental, but this one to be, like, a solo sport and be so mental, like, whatever. Koepka is in the lead at wherever, Masters on Sunday, and we've got the behind-the-scene coverage, whether it's later on or whatever. Like, that footage is sweet. So, I mean – just thinking about being followed around with a camera and stuff like that, like, I don't know. Obviously, they're used to it, but I don't know. Behind-the-scenes stuff and the F1 level of it is a different level. So, I don't know. It'll be cool. I'm all about it.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to be, like, interviewing them during the tournament and, like, getting – there's probably something in the contract where it's, like, once the round starts, you know, there's certain – rules in terms of, because there's all, yeah, like you said, there's always camera, like they're used to the cameras being around, but it's a difference when it's invasive versus just there. So I mean, I'm sure it's going to be, yeah, like you said, they're probably paying them a lot of money to get them on board because they already have so many pressure, they have so much pressure already and so many other things to deal with. But I mean, it's going to be awesome. Like I actually haven't watched the F1 series, so I need to watch that,
check because it out.
It's I've heard it's insane.
Must watch.
All right. Well, did you say it? Appreciate you.
I believe I did, but I can say it again.
Okay.
PGA Netflix. Appreciate you.
I think COVID's given me short-term memory loss as well. So, my next one, our guy Kayvon Thibodeau. He was talking to Joel Klatt. I believe this was on Fox. He was talking about the stigma of football players being dumb jocks. Really unfortunate that he happened to use the wrong word there. So he said, for me, I already hate the stigmatism of football players being dumb jocks. Do you know the stigmatism of Alabama education? It ain't the West Coast. It ain't Harvard. He also went on to say something about the Phil Knight connection and basically kind of was implying that, like, if he needed a job, he could call up Phil Knight if you're, you know, if you're an Oregon athlete, which I'm not entirely sure that's how it works, but wanted to hear it's still eligible. We want to, you know, inform people and be entertaining, but also helpful. So astigmatism is an imperfection in the curvature of your eye's cornea or lens. So he kind of made up a word there. He was trying to say stigma. So just kind of unfortunate, less unfortunate because he's about to make millions upon millions of dollars as most likely the number one pick in the draft. But he was kind of getting roasted for that. So that was kind of tough to see for our guy.
That was the weirdest interview ever. I think if you, whatever, haven't seen it, go look at it on Twitter. But that, like, 2-minute clip is one of the most uncomfortable things I've ever seen in my life. So,
yeah.
I don't know. He was trying to make a lot of statements and a lot of things, and it was just weird. I didn't enjoy it. But, yeah, I mean, I think I don't have astigmatism. I have something funky with my vision is atrocious. But, yeah, shout him out. That was uncomfortable, to say the least.
I keep telling you, you got to get LASIK. I did it a few years back, and it's still, like, the best thing I've ever done, so... This is not an advertisement for LASIK. It's just me trying to help you out.
Maybe one day. Are you giving appreciate you out there? Yeah, go for it.
Kayvon, well, to my eye doctor, appreciate you. Did a great job. But I guess, yeah. I mean, Joel Klatt, before I wrap this one up, he tweeted something today. I'll look up exactly what he said, but he was kind of just saying, like, he said, no excuses. Should have pushed back. Fact is, University of Alabama education is very good. And he replied to our guy, I think Josh Pate tweeted him, and he kind of said, like, I didn't really know what was going on. It was confusing. And I think everybody who has seen it understands why it was confusing. So
I mean, Kayvon looked like, yeah, he was given, it almost looked like he was given an interview. Weird. I don't like it.
Yeah, so we all make mistakes. Kayvon Thibodeau, unfortunate use of a word that does not exist, but we still appreciate you.
Love it. Playoffs. My next appreciate you goes out to the NFL playoffs. Kick off this weekend. Got some good matchups. If you're like me, you don't have a team in the playoffs. The Browns, unfortunately, did not make it there. We don't need to get into that. But, I mean, we got to love a few more weeks of football. And, I mean, the shift from us for a little NFL focus, whatever. I don't know. I just enjoy football top to bottom. And there's nothing like a good playoff upset. So we got some good matchups this weekend. And I'm interested to see how that moves going forward. So NFL playoffs. This is, like I said, I normally give these random calendar updates throughout the year. And, I mean, I'm sure people are well aware of the NFL going on. It's interesting because there's some people that are way bigger NFL fans. Like being in Dallas, like, I mean, this is a Cowboys town, right? And a lot of these people don't care about the college football stuff, but we've been all over. Obviously we're all in on college football, but it'll be a big weekend here in Dallas as they take on the Niners and some of the other games. So I'll be glued to the TV and playoffs, NFL playoffs. Appreciate you. There we go.
Normally we would take a break here, but yeah, we don't have to because we don't have to turn our camera off.
No, we're just cooking at this point,
which is nice. I mean, yeah, I guess at this point, let's kind of talk next season. I mean, we're done. I'm confident in saying that our primary sport that we cover is college football. And so for it to be over, I mean, the college football never sleeps, especially now with the way that the game is. But I mean, I guess just in terms of wrapping up this season and looking ahead, it's kind of like, I don't know, you alluded to this earlier. I mean, Alabama is clearly, like, in every poll that I've seen, they're ranked number one. And just even if you just say the sentence alone of Bryce Young and Will Anderson Jr. coming back, I mean, that's potentially the top two picks in the NFL draft, based on, you know, depending on draft order and everything else like that. So that's terrifying. I know the ESPN poll that I saw had Ohio State ranked number two. So it's, I guess, as an Ohio State fan, realistically knowing that you may be going up against Bama in the finals next year, I guess, how does that make you feel? Because personally, that's kind of terrifying.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely terrifying. I mean, I think Alabama well deserved the number one spot, far and beyond everybody else. I mean, Georgia obviously wins it this year, but they're going to lose so many guys in the draft, and their defense is ridiculous. But I mean, Ohio State, looking forward to next season. Got a bunch of new coaches in there. Obviously,
yeah, a lot hired like today. And yeah, like in the last few days.
Yeah, so the defense will be a new look to it, which I think obviously is what needs to happen there. And I don't know, Henderson coming back, CJ Stroud coming back. It'll be interesting to see that receiver room kind of rotate up, because obviously Olave Wilson leaving, and it's the next man up mentality. So we've obviously seen Ninjigba, Marvin Harrison Jr., some other guys, incoming guys, whatever. So I mean, it's an exciting time. I mean, I think obviously we can get into some of our predictions for next year, but I can spoil one. But I mean, I think Ohio State bounces back. I mean, obviously an off year for them, losing two games, which is not really like we had a podcast a while ago where I talked about, like, that's not the standard at Ohio State. The standard's going 12-0, Big Ten champs, beating Michigan, and going to CFP. So I think it's a huge year, huge bounce back year, and hopefully they can make some stuff happen. But yeah, I think Alabama deserves to be number one. I'll take number two. We go open up the year. Ohio State does at home against Notre Dame. So I mean, obviously jumping right into it. People have Notre Dame all over top 10 going next year. Obviously first year head coach, if you will, on their end. So it'll be interesting. I'm sure they'll be ready to roll. coming to Columbus and trying to keep Ohio State down like they were this past season. So I don't know. Exciting stuff. I can't wait for college football again. We had so much fun this past year. But, yeah, that's my first thought. And I guess for you, I'll throw it back at you. But Michigan, obviously top five, top 10, whatever, making their first CFP. I mean, I guess the big thing is you got to figure out if Harbaugh is coming back. But I guess your thoughts going into next season on your end.
Yes, there just clearing my throat there. I mean, I think that obviously we talked about it on a recent episode with Harbaugh, and I think on the day that we recorded, it was kind of like that was like the biggest, you know, trending topic on Twitter, and that was all anyone was talking about. I think we were talking about this earlier today that we just got, not that this necessarily ensures that he's coming back, but we got Mike Elston as our new D-line coach. So he's Notre Dame's defensive line coach, and that, I mean, that was a pretty, he's a former Michigan player. It's a pretty big hire, and everybody's speculating that you don't make that kind of hire, and you can't convince that kind of person to come unless there's some kind of guarantee that Harbaugh's coming back. And I talked pretty at length during that episode about kind of like just my thoughts on what I think Michigan needs to do. And obviously we both worked in these athletic departments, and so we kind of understand it more than the common person. But I mean, if he gets some of the support with like trying to ramp up the NIL stuff to kind of compete with the Texas A&M and some of these other schools that are taking advantage of it, I feel like there's a decent chance he comes back. I mean, everyone's saying, and I think you were saying too, like the Raiders are probably the best spot. His, I believe he met his wife in Las Vegas, but she's from there. She used to work there, and he like has some.
You don't necessarily want to meet your wife in Las Vegas.
Yeah.
It
could be good or bad. So there's always those family dynamics, but like I was saying, I mean, he lives close to his parents. I mean, I believe his kids are going to some of the schools that he went to, and so it's like there's things there where if I were him, it's like obviously there was a lot of turmoil at the end of last year, and so I understand looking into some of these other jobs. And I know he was telling some recruits that he was considering it, which like it's kind of something where you're like, eh, that's not great, but also appreciate the honesty. So my take on it is still that he's going to come back. I think he's probably going to get some of these things that he's asking for to stay competitive. And it's like from a roster standpoint, I mean, you're going to have the quarterback battle. Donovan Edwards came on big in our final game. Blake Corum was kind of hurt throughout the end of the year. They were, I mean, our running game's pretty ridiculous. And then we're getting Ronnie Bell back. We're getting Eric All back. Our O-line, you know, was great this year. We're going to have some replacements. And then obviously the big changes is losing Hutchinson and Ojabo at the, you know, the edge defensive end roles, which is going to be rough. I mean, we were super lucky to have both of those guys. But I mean, I think kind of where we're at ranking wise makes a lot of sense. That ESPN had us at number five. So it's like, I don't know, I'll definitely take that based on the last few years. But at the same time, I definitely feel like, I mean, you got Ohio State will be favored in that game next year, unless you're losing, you know, your first couple of games, because the talent level that you guys have, and to have Stroud back is just kind of nuts. So if your defense can figure it out, which it sounds like they will based on the hires, then I don't know, not to say this year was a fluke, but that game becomes much more terrifying with you guys having a more competent defense.
I think regardless, it's gonna be a good game coming into it because of this year you guys have run all that stuff. But yeah, I mean, it just is, it'd be mind-blowing for me for Harbaugh not to get some of the stuff he's asking for, considering like whatever his job is to do what he did this year and to compete mm-hmm. for national titles and whatever. And if he wants something, I think he should get it. I think that's how most places and most coaches should be, that actually think that they can contend for a national championship. I mean, obviously, Alabama and Georgia, in my opinion, were the best two teams this year, competed in the national championship, and it was everything we wanted in that regard. But if you're trying to compete and trying to be up there with the big dogs, then you gotta do what you gotta do to get there. And I don't know, it just wouldn't make sense to me if they didn't get that. So I mean, we'll see. Only time will tell. But I think, you know, he's running out of time. Everyone's running out of time. Like, something's gonna happen here soon. So we'll stay put on that. There we go. How about some, we'll wrap it up. How about some predictions for next year? I think we wrote down a few of our favorites that we think is way too early predictions, if you will, next college football season.
You want to snake draft it so that we go back That's and forth? Because we may have some, I'll just.
You can go first if you'd like.
Is it because I have COVID or had COVID?
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
All right. My number one prediction for next season, Caleb Williams is going to be playing for Lincoln Riley, and that's going to be at USC, since that is where Lincoln Riley is coaching now. I think all the moves that have been made recently in terms of Jackson Dart is out of there, and I think Caleb's gonna end up there is my prediction. I think it's either USC or Oklahoma. Like, come back to Oklahoma, and given that Gabriel transferred there, I think that he's gonna end up going with Lincoln.
I don't know if you can see this, but I already photoshopped UCLA on his nails, so we got that ready to roll for nice. When that does happen. So I would agree with that, even though that's, I mean, yeah, we'll see. My first prediction, and this one I hate to say, but I'm going to say it anyways, is Clemson bounces back, wins the ACC again. Obviously, this year was a good year for a lot of those teams in the ACC who haven't been relevant in a long time. Kenny Pickett, Wake Forest, all those guys. It's just hard to believe that Clemson stays down for more than a year. Obviously, people have their off years. This was one of them, even though they still won, I think, 10 games. You know, they lose their DC, but I don't know. I don't agree with a lot of things Dabo does in hiring internally. They did some weird stuff this offseason. I don't like Dabo. I never will like Dabo. Dabo could be sitting right next to me, and I would tell him that. Not a fan of Dabo. That being said, Clemson ACC champs next year. My prediction, number one.
Nice. So, shocking that you still don't like Dabo, and that hasn't changed
Never
since
will.
You last talked
Never
about
will.
It. My next one may be the how to put this, riskiest pick that I have, but I'm also trying to maintain some friendships I've made recently. So I got Will Anderson Jr. winning the Heisman. I think that with the numbers that he could potentially put up, and obviously with I mean, you saw with like Hutchinson this year at Michigan, it's like if you have a talented D-line overall and they can't, you know, a lot of these great pass rushers on schools that aren't as good, it's like you can kind of just double team them and take them out of the game. With everyone at Alabama basically being a 4 and 5 star, because the numbers he put up were crazy, and we talked about, like, he should have been in New York, and just meeting him as a person, and he just really seems like it's going to be straight to a, you know, top 5 pick in the NFL from this point on for him. Like, I don't see him having any issues or training, you know, issues with training or whatever it is. He just seems like he's got his head on straight, and he's a great kid. So I think he's going to be the first defensive player since my guy Charles to win the Heisman.
I would like to say you're right. I would like to say I agree with that. I like Will Anderson. Good dude. Nice dude. I think he probably makes it to New York. I don't think he'll win it just because of the way people vote and how it is. Like, obviously, you know, I don't know. Being an Ohio State guy, I'd love to see Stroud win it, but I don't know. I don't think it's going to be he's an absolute beast. I think he should have been there this year, but they hate giving it to defensive players, so we'll see. I wouldn't mind seeing it. Love the guy. My next one, we're going to stick with just who wins the conference for a minute. It's this might be my boldest as well. USC, I think that they win the Pac-12 in Lincoln's first year. They have a pretty easy start to their schedule. I pulled it up. It's Rice, Stanford, Fresno State, Oregon State, Arizona State, Washington State, and then Utah. So, I mean, I think it's a pretty start to the year. And then they have Arizona, Cal, Colorado, UCLA, Notre Dame. So I think that they can do enough to win the conference. They don't even have to, you know, play Oregon in the conference championship if Oregon even has the year that they're expected. Obviously, new head coach there and everything that goes along with it. But I don't know. It's Lincoln Riley. Obviously, he's there for a reason. I think, you know, if Caleb Williams does go there, that obviously helps significantly. And we'll see how it goes. But Dabo, Lincoln Riley, winning their conferences next year. First two picks.
Yeah, I mean, that Utah game at Utah, obviously, just ranking-wise, I think they're ranked seventh, at least on the ESPN poll going into the season, which, I mean, makes sense. I mean, they had a great season this year. They're returning a lot of guys. But, yeah, I mean, the whole point of that Lincoln Riley hire was kind of that, like, if you – can create a dominant roster there, you're going to have an easier time than really pretty much any other, I guess, major conference, just given how it's set up currently. So I like that pick. I'm picking not against Michigan here, but this pains me to predict, but I'm going to do it anyway. I think CJ Stroud, obviously didn't pick him to win the Heisman, but I am picking him to repeat as Big Ten Conference Offensive Player of the Year. And then I got him, similar to our guy Stetson, I got him as the CFP Offensive MVP next year. So I think that Ohio State is going to make a run next year. I see them having a great season. And then if they can make it to the finals, it's like I see that being – not a guarantee. I mean, that's not a guarantee, but these are predictions. So sure, I'm guaranteeing it in a sense. But he's seeing him up close, and even I guess just in that Michigan game, like I was terrified of him the entire time. And how athletic he is, and how accurate he is, I think he's gonna have a monster season.
There you go. I love it. That leads nicely into my next one, which is Ohio State reclaiming the Big Ten title. I think that. Like I said, it's a bounce back year. I think obviously that, you know, includes a win over Michigan at home, everything that goes along with it. So, I mean, I'm just going boom, 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 conference titles, conference championships, but I'm now Buckeyes, Big Ten next year, number three. There you go.
That I don't love that pick, but I understand that pick. This next one, maybe I'm a little too much influenced by all these NIL stories, but I got Texas A&M making the CFP. Obviously, going there this year and seeing kind of what that program is all about, and kind of seeing what Jimbo's been able to kind of get going there, and then, how they're recruiting. I mean, obviously, some of those guys are going to make immediate impacts, and I just saw, I think, a few minutes ago, like, I think their three-year starter on safety is coming back and just announced it. It's like they have enough guys coming back to be dangerous. And obviously they've, you know, haven't been able to kind of break in that upper echelon of teams, but also beating Alabama this year. Obviously they're going to have a different starting quarterback this year. But yeah, I mean, I think they're kind of making that push into the discussion of top teams, and yeah, I think they're going to make the CFP, which I think just having a few different teams making it and starting to kind of divvy it up will make college football more interesting. So Texas A&M, gig them.
There you go. I like that. I think, you know, it's always good to see a new team in the CFP or a new team win it. Obviously Georgia win it this year. It just adds something new. People get sick of the Alabamas and Clemsons and whatever. So it'd be cool to have somebody new in there. We'll see. I'm going to stick in the state of Texas for my next one. I'm going to say Texas is mildly back this year. Texas beats Oklahoma for the first time since 2018 regular season. I think Quinn Ewers, I'm excited to see him play. Obviously, wish he was going to be in the Scarlet and Gray this year. Instead, he's put on the burnt orange. And then Bijan Robinson, just coming back for another year. I mean, he has to, but he's a beast. And you think about, you know, obviously we haven't seen Quinn play, but big things expected down there. Off year, horrible year for Texas. But I think that it's interesting to see, you know, Quinn Ewers and Robinson. That's like that's a 1-2 punch right there. I think it like rivals Ohio State for what it's worth. CJ Stroud and Henderson. It'll be interesting. But Texas hasn't beat Oklahoma in a very long time. Oklahoma new head coach, bunch of new stuff going on there. Sorry to the podcast on the prairie, but Texas taking down Oklahoma this year as my next one.
Nice. That looked like it was going to happen this year, but obviously Caleb and company
thought otherwise.
Altered that ending. My final prediction, I guess I didn't really work out the specifics here, but I just have someone signing an NIL deal for $5+ million. I don't know. I guess that's probably a little easier if you break that up over 4 years. But I believe that we're going to have some more. I feel like this year, we talked about it earlier, like the NIL thing came out kind of right before the season. So it was kind of a mad scramble to figure all this out and figure out deals and whatever. And so players are going to have pretty much from now or when their bowl game ended until the fall to figure out some deals. And so we've also talked about, like, I mean, Quinn had some crazy deals at Ohio State and kind of, you know, secured the bag. So like props to him, but the people on the other end of it are starting to get smarter with how they're structuring the deals. And, but it's also just, I feel like college football's value is only going up. And so, I'm excited to see some of these guys, especially like the Stetson Bennett's of the world, who maybe aren't going to be making NFL money, make some good money.
You gotta get off that flip phone.
Yeah,
you gotta get off that flip phone if you're trying to make some money. I like that. It'll be interesting. I think that they're going to kind of rein in the rules there on NIL and what's allowed to go down. And I don't know. There's still so much movement and so many discussions that are still going on around college football and everything that entails. So it'll be interesting to see. I mean, I don't know. Like I said, Caleb Williams out in L.A., you think that there's a $5 million somewhere out there for him. So We'll see. All right, my last one, Alabama goes to their third straight national championship. I think that is not out of the question by any means. They're the favorite coming into the year. I think that Bryce Young is going to have a chip on his shoulder. Will Anderson's going to have a chip on their shoulder. Yeah, I think it's – last week I was thinking that they might win their third straight, which I don't think Saban's ever done, but this one is going to their third straight. So that is my fifth and final prediction for this coming season. That is all I got on my end. Pat, you got anything to add?
Nothing except for we need to do some college basketball research. We've been kind of – Full on college football fans this year, and got to be honest, we at least me, I can speak for myself saying I do not know as much as I need to know about college basketball right now. So we're kind of shifting our focus now and trying to kind of catch up on that so we can provide the knowledge and the takes that you need to hear. But yeah, I mean, great football season. Obviously, we got to do a bunch of traveling and get to know, you know, these players and fans and all the traditions and have all these experiences. So, I mean, it was a crazy season to experience, and obviously it's going to keep being a wild off season with the way the game is shifting. So we're shifting a bit, but still follow us on social. I'm going to just check that video real quick and see where it's at view wise.
Check that. Yeah, we gotta hop into basketball season here. Ohio State takes on Wisconsin tonight, so I'm gonna check that out. I haven't tuned into a game in a minute, and yeah, but this year, sweet year, awesome year, been able to do some cool stuff. Excited about the future and everything that went with it. So yeah, we had, I mean, CFP, going to CFP, going to Natty, SEC championship, everywhere along the way. Like our job's pretty sweet. We've got to do some cool stuff. So appreciate you all coming along for the ride. Pat, what's that video look like?
We got, let's see here, 584,000 views. So
there you go.
Jack's friend is more famous than us right now.
Yeah, popping off. Well, we'll give you an update.
Eric,
next week.
Eric, is that his name?
Eric with a K. I'm sure he's loving it. Told you, let me pull it up. I texted him. We were texting this morning because I posted a TikTok of, not the one that's going nuts, but a different one earlier at the game. And I was like, you're getting kind of roasted on TikTok. There we go, the dogs. So you're kind of getting roasted on TikTok. I'm trying to wrap it up, man.
Yeah. Hey, here's your chance.
I don't even know if I can keep going. Here we go. And I said, whatever. I said, I'm working on a TikToker now to make you look even more bandwagon than ever. So, whatever. Here we go. Bury him. Yeah, he's a good friend. Bandwagon.
We got it. We got to wrap it up because the dogs are going crazy. Just like the Georgia Bulldogs. But thank you for listening. Follow us on our social media. We have a TikTok, and leave a review. Do everything that we ask you to do every week. But thank you for listening, and hopefully I will not have COVID the next episode we record.
All right, till next time.